The way I describe the current water situation in Kansas is just recently coming out of the 4 or 5 year drought here in Stanton County in Southwest Kansas, really put a reality check on everyone, and it was severe. Personally, I lost half of my rate, my gallons per minute that I was able to obtain from my irrigation wells. During that time.
I think one of the issues that's coming is that water is almost more important, we've discovered now, than energy sources in terms of economic development and economic activity. And all of those studies that I've previously worked on have estimated large impacts associated with a lack of water going forward, so that it would constrain the level of economic and human activity quite severely, because we just don't have the water in the right places to be able to service the economy and human activity that we would need going forward.
Everyone knew that that groundwater was a big river coming from Colorado, and it was inexhaustible. It would never run out.
There's not a living thing on this planet that can sustain without water.
It's a basics of life.
Water is extremely critical. Whatever we do, if we run out of water, then we're in big, big trouble. Humans, livestock, and even plants must have water. And we must do all we can to have water available for the expanding population that we have today.
Agriculture's always been extremely important for wildlife. In Kansas, you're going to have some impacts, you know, from dry, hot years regardless. But the one thing that you do see is some consistency around irrigation agriculture. This agency has made Kansas a tremendous waterfowl opportunity. We have people coming from Arkansas. Arkansas is the capital of duck hunting, but people come up here to hunt geese, hunt sandhill cranes. You've got Shine Bottoms, which was purchased back in the 50s, that is a wetland of international significance, along with Quivira, which is right south of it. We have people coming from all over the country to view the shorebirds that come through there, both in the fall and spring migration. When our pheasant numbers went down in 2012, the places that you could find them generally were on circles that had grass corners. You had the habitat, but yet you had the water.
People in the eastern part of the state, they have some reservoirs. Imagine if you took those reservoirs away. What would those people do? Where would those people go? They'd have to leave. There wouldn't be any water. Okay, the same thing is true out here in western Kansas. The Ogallala is our water source. You take it away, it's like taking away a reservoir, because billions of dollars come into the Kansas economy from the use of water. Anybody that thinks everything is just going to be okay and we're just going to keep going like we are as we deplete the Ogallala, I don't think so.
The fundamental issue in Kansas is that the water is not located in the right areas, as it were. It tends to be towards the east of the state, and the west of the state, if you look at the expected demand for water, principally for agricultural purposes, but also to service a growing population, is going to be insufficient. The study that I've done for Kansas actually looks at the restricted availability of water against a baseline that allows for unconstrained growth, so there's freely available water, and the state grows as it would be expected to, based on the current patterns of business activity. And in the alternative world, I suppose the realistic world, where water would be constrained and there is no shift of water resources from the east to the west of the state, the economy would be about 240,000 jobs smaller. It would be about $18 billion smaller in current values, current prices. And obviously those things translate into the general population being poorer than it would otherwise be. It would severely curtail growth in the western part of the state.
In terms of water, Kansas is, in some respects, two states spliced together at roughly the 100th meridian. Eastern Kansas gets high levels of precipitation, more than 40 inches per year in our southeastern corner of the state, and has abundant sources of surface water in the form of lakes, rivers, and streams. Groundwater, however, is less plentiful in eastern Kansas and is generally most readily found in alluvial aquifers, mainly the sands and gravels adjacent to major rivers and streams. The abundant rainfall and runoff in eastern Kansas naturally replenishes these alluvial aquifers. But floods can also erode stream banks and carry silt into reservoirs, reducing the amount of storage space for water. Western Kansas is very different. Precipitation is scant, less than 15 inches per year in the far western parts of the state. So surface water is relatively rare. Today, virtually no perennial streams cut entirely across western Kansas, and all the lakes and reservoirs are man-made. Groundwater, however, is plentiful. The Ogallala Aquifer, which underlies the western third of the state, is the most widespread and largest source of stored water in Kansas. The Ogallala is primarily a layer of sand and gravel that eroded off the face of the Rocky Mountains over the past few million years and was washed out onto the plains of central and western Kansas by sluggish streams. In the pore space of those sands and gravels is water that has accumulated over thousands of years. The Ogallala varies widely from place to place. It may be more than 400 feet thick in southwestern Kansas, only 100 to 200 feet thick in northwestern Kansas, and missing in parts of west central Kansas, where it has been removed by erosion. Water in the Ogallala is generally of extremely high quality, and connected pore space in the aquifer allows large quantities of water to be removed relatively quickly. Still, under natural conditions, groundwater in the Ogallala moves slowly, taking decades to travel a mile. Natural recharge of water back into the Ogallala is relatively slow, generally only an inch or two per year. Where wells have been established to pump groundwater and the rate of groundwater pumping exceeds the local recharge rates, the water level drops, creating the ongoing challenge of extending the life of the aquifer and the water it holds.
You know, for generations, the economy out here was basically dependent upon the weather and the boom and bust cycles of the droughts every 15 to 25 years. And your population would spike up and down reflective of that too. But one of the things that did change this area and brought permanent settlement was the irrigation and the ability to sustain yourselves through those dry periods of time and bringing productivity to the lands where you could depend on a crop and raise your livestock.
The KU geologic team came in here and finally figured out that was prehistoric water and stored here millions of years in the past, and when it was gone, it was going to be gone, and that was a real reawakening for most of us on that.
Our area started out, as you might know, with flood irrigation. We started out with ditches, cutting the ditches out, and then you went from cutting the ditches out to going to siphon tubes to get the water across. And then you went from siphon tubes to gated pipe, and then later on, sprinklers came into being.
When we first started using center pivots, we had the old impact sprinkler head set on top of the pipe, and you go squirt, squirt like this, you know, and a lot of it was evaporating, truly. Then we figured out, well, okay, maybe we can improve on that.
Development of deep well turbine pumps in the 1940s and response to extended drought conditions in the 1950s led to rapid groundwater development in the 1960s. Local problem-solving Kansans saw that unregulated groundwater use was hastening the decline of local groundwater supplies. They insisted on the adoption of mandatory standards for water rights and limits on new demands in the interest of protecting the health and welfare of Kansas. And good state and local action followed when the state legislature passed the Groundwater Management District Act in 1972 and later required water rights for Kansas water use in 1978.
Some people say, why are you having a groundwater district to protect water? Well, you could see that it was going down. And so people got on board in a little while because, you know, at one time you could drill a well anywhere. It didn't matter. You could drill next to yours or anywhere. It didn't matter. But then we got limitations. You can only get so close to somebody else's well and had to have so good a formation to drill.
In that same decade, the Federal Water Resources Development Act of 1976 authorized the six-state High Plains Ogallala Aquifer Regional Resources Study, known as the High Plains Study, to address the problem of depleting High Plains Ogallala Aquifer water supplies. The U.S. Department of Commerce, in coordination with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and other federal, state, and private entities, examined the feasibility of various alternatives to provide adequate water supplies to assure continued economic growth and vitality of the High Plains region. The High Plains study included state-level research completed by each of the six states: Colorado, Kansas, Nebraska, New Mexico, Oklahoma, and Texas, consisting of regional economic and policy assessments and a study of interbasin water transfers. The Corps studied four alternative transfer routes and completed reconnaissance-level designs and cost estimates for ranges of transfer quantities. The 1982 alternative Route B reconnaissance study evaluated a route beginning on the Missouri River near the northeast corner of Kansas and terminating in a big storage reservoir in western Kansas.
The 1982 water study was an effort put on by the Corps of Engineers to determine whether or not there was usable supplies of water in the east along the Missouri River and some other places in Texas. But primarily what I know about the Kansas side of it was they looked at two different routes that were viable enough to bring water towards western Kansas as an irrigation slash municipal industrial project. At the time, we were coming right out of the late 1970s with the high oil and gas prices, and they just assumed that that would be a continuation and that eventually fuel prices would become so high that water transportation would just never happen. And as we see what we have today, that's not the case. In Arizona, they, at the exact same time, they went ahead and decided to build their project. And today, that has completely changed the state of Arizona's economy and landscape around.
To produce a 2015 update, the Kansas Water Office and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers Kansas City District entered into a federal planning assistance to states agreement to update the 1982 study Kansas transfer element. The update was not to put forward a specific plan to construct the transfer system conceptualized in 1982. Rather, it was to help Kansas evaluate the various merits and impacts such a project would have for Kansas. Many topics were raised during the course of this study that would need to be addressed if a project of this nature were to move forward.
We're never more than 10 days away from a drought in the summertime. As one of my old neighbors says, yeah, I remember last year when it rained both times. And we get heavy intensity of rains as well as periods of long drought. And we get that almost every spring or every fall. We have a period of maybe even 3 weeks or so that's really, really wet. Flash flood warnings are out for about 5 or 6 counties in southeast Kansas. If we could trap some of that water that's running off or hold it into reservoirs, we could have an excessive amount of water storage, and that water then could be used by agriculture practically anywhere.
As we look to extend and preserve the aquifer maintain that economic viability, we continue to use new technologies and utilize the new genetics that are more drought efficient, more water efficient, and then incorporate that with new farming practices. And in doing so, we're seeing some really good yields and advancements in saving water, but also doing it at an economically viable rate.
We were part of a pilot program to put up some of the first pivot monitoring full control systems back in the 90s. Using pivot monitors, we know exactly when the sprinkler shuts off, and we can go out and correct it right then and rather than let it sit there for however many hours till somebody notices it. We use variable rate irrigation technology to speed the sprinkler up and slow the sprinkler down. I use moisture probes in the ground to monitor root development and moisture availability and moisture usage, using satellite imagery to target areas. I have text alerts set up for a multitude of things. We all get busy and forget, but if I got something that's sitting here poking me saying, hey, there's a problem, and we can address it right away, it's a timing issue, it's a waste issue, and we can't have it at all. And so we do everything we can to mitigate those instances when something isn't right, using that information to better help me see what I can do in the future, what's working, what's not working. That's the kind of things that, that technology has allowed for us to use to conserve more and do better with less.
I've been pretty pleased with the last 4 years and the direction that I've seen people going and the emphasis that's been put on sustainability for the aquifer. I think we're improving, I really do.
In looking at some of these new technologies, we've had tremendous amount of support from a lot of companies in the field, both in terms of irrigation suppliers, those that either provide direct product in terms of center pivot products, for example, but we've also seen a lot of support recently from other ag resources as well. For example, our local Garden City Co-op has provided a tremendous amount of resources in terms of how we manage that water once it's through the pivot.
Well, agriculture's always been very willing to conserve and take care of the environment if they had the money to do that, and that's why, we had incentive programs.
I'm going to talk about how we use water in the dairy. We use all the water in the dairy three times. First trip for the water is we take the water and run it through the milk chiller, okay, and we drop the temperature of the milk from 98 down to about 68 degrees. Then the second use of that water is we flush the parlor. And so all the urine, manure, just like a toilet, goes into these holding ponds, okay? And then the third use is we take that water that's now nutrient enriched and we pump it out on these fields to grow corn. And so we can grow corn or any other crop. So that's a big deal.
When I really left the farm, which was about 7 years ago, we had almost gone completely no-till. We probably, as far as conserving moisture, we're doing I don't know how many fold times better job conserving the moisture that we had to what we did even when I started farming as a young adult.
Around here, there's no doubt in my mind that, irrigation has a limited lifetime. We've gone practically all dry land ourselves, and it's going to happen more.
If the water's not here for the irrigation and we're just dry land farming, the amount of people that it'll take will be cut, divided by 20 at least. And when you got 2,200 people in your county, that doesn't leave very many people left.
Will dry land techniques sustain the current economy we have here in Western Kansas? I think the real short, easy answer is no, it will not. If you would just take the Ogallala away, say it just went away right now, well, I don't think you'd have these feedlots. I don't think you'd have these dairies. You wouldn't have all these grain elevators and equipment manufacturers and sales, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Why does Southeast or Eastern Kansas farmers not irrigate? There's two or three reasons. One is water availability. Now, if they're not close to a creek or a river where they can pump directly out of it, then that becomes a limitation. But the second thing is our soil. I have to laugh about this because some of my friends in Western Kansas will say, but you get 40 inches of rainfall a year, why do you have droughts? It's the soil. It's soil. Because of thousands of years of high rainfall, our soil, the clay that was in the surface of the soil, has been moved down anywhere from 10 to maybe 15 inches below the surface, and it has formed an extremely hard, dense layer of soil that's called a clay pan. Being on the Neosho River Advisory Committee, we're looking at various ways to do two things. Number one is to reduce the sediment in the river. And if you reduce sediment, then you also reduce nutrients and improve the water quality. So, how do we go about doing that? Currently, of course, the dredging of John Redmond Reservoir is in progress. When I first heard of the idea of dredging, I thought, oh my, what a waste of money. Well, if we're, and under the current, I'm going to say current conservation programs and problems, that's our only alternative unless we're going to let the lake fill up with sediment. In my opinion, we have enough technology and farming and agricultural sense that we should not have sedimentation going into these reservoirs to the point where we gotta dig it out. That is one of the things that our advisory committee is seriously looking at. Increasing the storage in existing reservoirs probably is some of the best money that we could spend. Just adding a foot or two to the top of those current thresholds would store a lot of water.
One of the biggest concerns, I think, regarding additional water transportation is the cost. When you're looking at a significant investment of that scale, then I think what you have to look at as well is, okay, what are potential values that we would generate from that cost, that investment that we'd make in it. So not only potentially values from irrigation, for example, in western Kansas, but maybe other industries, resources, other uses along the way. If we just look at any type of investment opportunity simply from a cost perspective, we wouldn't do them or make a lot of those investments.
There's some things we can do that are much different from the 1982 study, which was too expensive to build and proceed with. The updated study kind of shows there is some more viability to that, and we can do that by partnering with some of our neighbors to the west. The value of their water is extremely high. And if there's a way where we can ladder water or substitute water that's coming to the east and let them keep and maintain that water in their systems, we can work together to alleviate some of those costs. Another thing we have is utilization of some of our local resources. We have both a good supply of cheap natural gas and also a large wind farm infrastructure being built in Kansas.
We're going to have to lift the water at least 16 times to come across the state. Well, it takes power and energy and money to do that. Well, what if we put a gas line going from west to east and we have the ability to use natural gas to run those generating lifting stations? This system could be flexible. We could adjust very easily. When the grid doesn't have the extra energy figured into what it needs, we could turn the natural gas down and take in wind energy. When the wind energy was lighter than it was expected and the grid needs more power, we can go to our natural gas generated power.
The water project will be a very good user of that spare power and be able to help utilize some of that unneeded power and bring benefits both to the water supply and also to our local power grids by balancing the amount of power produced versus the actual demand. And in doing so, we bring value to everyone.
And the aquifer just continues to go down, just continues to slip. But it's out of sight, see? Toilets work, water comes out of the fountain, irrigation works, it's out of sight. The pond's going away, but it's out of sight. If it was a great big reservoir, like Lake Powell, where you could see it, there'd be more concern, but that's people.
If everything's going great, why do you want to change? That's our human mind, you know?
You absolutely cannot make it look like a smart thing with today's dollars, but that's not what we're going to be working with. It's going to be tomorrow's dollars that are going to be paying off. And if you look at the world and you look at the amount of farm ground that gets eaten up by urban sprawl, and you look at the growing populations around the world and how much farm ground we're going to lose, how valuable is farm ground going to be, and how valuable is the water going to be that you're going to put on the crops that are going to feed this world?
Sure, cost is an issue, but you have to solve these things, we have to start on them. And if we start on them and have conversations, and we'll find solutions. But you can't just set your feet in concrete and say, no, we're not going to do this, we're not going to look at it. I mean, that's not how we do things.
We need to look at this as a long-term project that's going to bring benefits to the state of Kansas for generations. The upfront costs will be substantial, but we can work through that, and in the end, generations from now, they'll wonder how we did without it.
All of us humans, you know, we want everything, but oh, by the way, don't put it in my backyard. So we need a reservoir. Well, where are you going to build a reservoir? Well, you're not going to take my farm. Okay, that's how we all think. People are going to have to kind of give a little bit. There's issue after issue after issue, but people have to try to think into the future. All the big, nice, great industrial economic things that have happened all over the state of Kansas, those were not done by non-doers.
When the aqueduct talks started happening, I at first just really didn't think that it was feasible or that the rest of the state or government would get behind it. And when the drought hit here, I started really thinking about how this could work. And it's not just bring water from the eastern Kansas to western Kansas and stop. I'm talking a intricate, well thought out, well developed system in this country to take water from where it's in excess to where it's in demand.
I think water transportation programs have a place, and the challenge is being able to get the right to transfer that water. But I think it's something that if we don't look at it, we're being fairly short-sighted. I mean, you know, I think the Incas were transporting water. You know, we've been doing it. It's not something new. The people that bite the bullet and do water transportation projects, as you go down the road a ways, if you go to California, if you look at what's gone, Lake Mead, monies that they put into that, it makes them look like geniuses because somebody bit the bullet and recognized, you know, what was gonna happen. The generation before us was very good at infrastructure projects. They did them, and we've reaped the benefit of that. I don't know that this generation has been very good about looking down the road and building infrastructure projects because the previous generation built so many. That's the first uphill battle is creating an understanding of public infrastructure and how it plays a role in developing economy. I think we're at a point in time in political thought that there's not a great appreciation for that. And I think that's going to be the biggest challenge.
We've researched and looked into the aspects of a water transportation program, and we visited sites in California and Arizona and even been to Washington, D.C. a time or two to learn the process and what we need to do going forward. One of the first things you see is how very apparent the value of water is.
A great model, I think, for Kansas would be to look at the Central Arizona Project, which is an effective method of supplying sufficient water to allow for the growth in the Central Corridor. The Central Arizona Project is a 336-mile long canal that connects the Colorado River, draws water from the Colorado River, and supplies the state with approximately 1.5 million acre-feet of water per annum. And a study that I did here estimated that over 50% of the economy is reliant upon the water that is drawn from the Colorado River and shipped from an area of the state where it isn't useful to areas of the state where it is the lifeblood of the local economy.
To see how much effort they put in obtaining and locking in future sources of water and the value they place on that today, even though that water may not be developed or utilized for another 20 or 30 years. They realize the aspect is once it's gone, it's gone.
If Missouri is having torrential rains and flooding is imminent, Missouri could call up and say, we're in bad shape, please take out 200,000 acre feet as fast as you can to limit the damage that we're gonna have. Okay, my opinion, that could be Missouri's water. Colorado could call up and say, hey, we want to buy that. California could call up and say, we want to buy that. And our aqueduct would transport it to them. We would get the shipping of it. Then they have to buy the product. Now you've got money that should be Missouri's money to help them offset their flood damage. They're not having to get as much federal relief. They're not having to get as much relief from others. They're generating their own relief fund. My fear is that if we don't get proactive as a state and say, we are going to work on this and develop this because this is the future of the state and the country, it will happen to us. There will be aqueducts built to move water. Either you're a part of it and you benefit from it, or you get 10 cents on the dollar and watch it go right on out the state line. It's gonna happen.
As we have less water to use in the state of Kansas, you know, into the future, how's that gonna affect the state? How's that gonna affect the people? Well, you know, you need a tax base. You maybe don't want to pay taxes, but you have to pay taxes to support the state of Kansas. And if your economic base is deteriorating, there's less economic activity in the state of Kansas, and you know, everything is tied back to water.
Water's going to continue to be a critical component of, you know, life, not only in Kansas and our state, but around the world. Obviously, water is a fundamental item that we need for all of our activities, to drink, to grow food, for lifestyle, recreational purposes.
We're really in the quality of life business in Kansas. We've been talking about that for 6 years, but that's becoming more and more important part of the conversations that people have when they talk about how do you recruit new businesses to Kansas, how do you recruit new people to Kansas to work in those businesses, and it's a quality of life issue. About 65 years ago, we didn't have a single federal reservoir in Kansas. Now we've got 24. We've got 43 state fishing lakes. We've got 235 community lakes. So just think how just those reservoirs, those bodies of water have changed the landscape and changed the opportunities in Kansas. And those have become important recreation lakes. And consequently, recreation has become an important part of the economies of those areas. And if you go into those areas, you'll have a completely different conversation today than you would have had 50 years ago. Now people understand what that water can do. And because recreation is a non-consumptive user of water, you can do anything else you want to do because recreation is not using the water, and it's just a great opportunity for develop the quality of life all across Kansas.
We're all in this together, and so if people will work together, we can solve these things. You know, hell, we went to the moon, you know, landing on the moon by working together, so there's lots of other things we can do.
One of the great things about Western Kansas here is we've got really good deep soils. We've got a good climate for raising livestock, whether it's beef, swine, or dairy. And with that climate, we've got a lot of advantages here over a lot of other areas where we can see the growth and development of these higher value usages of our water and land. Here in the state of Kansas, agriculture is still the largest economic engine in the state. And whether it's land taxes on irrigated systems and production, or the feedlots and dairies, or the jobs that are created to service those industries, you know, we see a gaining value that goes through the economy based off what starts with an irrigated field of corn or wheat and, you know, progresses through to tax rolls in town and in the state, as well as jobs and homes and families.
From a state perspective and a national perspective, we need this concentrated animal agriculture here in the high plains. This is where it's adapted, okay? Low humidities, low rainfall, no surface water, no water to pollute. Okay, it's very well situated to this environment. But if we lose the Ogallala, then we'll start to lose our economic base.
The number that I've heard is an irrigated acre in the state of Kansas generates $4,000 annually in state revenue. So you plant an irrigated acre, and in the turn of the money spent in the state to fertilize it, water it, buy the seed, have the equipment, have the employees have kids in school, the employees are buying groceries, they're buying clothes, they're going to the movies, all of that turn from an irrigated acre has been said to be $4,000 annually, even if you say it's $2,000. And you talk about the amount of insured irrigated acres in Southwest Kansas that we've lost in the last 3 years, it's astounding.
Probably our greatest asset here in Western Kansas is the water that we have available to us out of the aquifer. You know, we're able to withstand droughts and hard, dry times and maintain our economy, maintain our tax base, and keep growing and moving forward as we innovate and become more efficient.
What can we do to take what would be a catastrophic natural disaster and generate it into a project that's good for the state, good for the local, good for the national, good for the ecosystem, and a conservation issue all the way across? How do you take those lemons and make lemonade?
If you don't have sufficient water, people won't arrive because they won't be able to get housing, affordable housing. If there aren't sufficient people in a state, you don't have the labor market, the supply side of labor, to be able to allow the economy to grow naturally. And that means the state is going to be restricted in terms of its growth, both in terms of its population and in terms of its economic activity. So Kansas as a whole would suffer significantly if it can't come up with some way of servicing the water demands in the west of the state from the resources that are available in the east.
Gradually, we are moving east and east and east, and more of our population is over in the eastern part of the state, and that's not necessarily good for our state either. I mean, when we can disperse our population across the entire state, it'd be a lot better. Kansas is a great state, and our biggest problem is the perception of ourselves. When people come to Kansas, and we see it all the time, we see soldiers that come to Fort Riley that never leave because they come to Kansas and they fall in love with it. They get to Kansas and they love Kansas because there's so much opportunity, and you just take Wichita, for example. There's so much opportunity, there's so many opportunities for culture in Wichita, but you can be out in the country in 15 minutes. And if you're in Chicago, Illinois, or if you're in Dallas, Texas, you cannot do that. You know, we have an increasing wine business in Kansas. The challenge that our vintners have is that most of them are in an urban area. That's where they're starting. And so their biggest problem is their neighbors don't like the traffic that's being created because of the success they're having with these vineyards. And if there was enough people away from the urban area that we could have our vineyards, you know, in a more rural setting, I think our vineyards would be much bigger than they are right now because they're really limited by the locations that they're at and their inability to expand.
We have the infrastructure, we have the know-how, we have the ability, we have everything in place to continue to do that and to continue to learn to be better and continue to expand on it, except for water. That's the one thing that this area lacks.
The opportunity cost of waiting to develop a sustainable supply of water for the West is going to be severe. When we lose that ability for long-term dependable water, that's where business and industry decide, you know what, that we can't continue to invest. You know, the farmers look at it and decide, you know, I can't continue to upgrade my systems. I can't continue to spend money on new technology to work to preserve and utilize that water to its highest value. And I'm afraid if that event ever occurs, it'll be extremely difficult to rebuild because you'll start from ground zero again in a lot of cases. And that's just not something that we need to do. And to be honest, it'd be just terrible planning by the part of our leaders and foresight of our communities.
I think water is one of the most critical issues in determining economic activity and growth, and Kansas is just a microcosm of that. It just doesn't have sufficient water in its western region to be able to service the growth that could occur there if water resources become available. So it's absolutely crucial as an economic lifeblood to the state.
So how do we tackle all these issues? If I'm going to create something new, first it starts with an idea, okay? Then you start to develop an action plan. And then you start moving through, and a big part of getting something done is you have to be brave, because people will look at you and say, what's he doing? That won't work. Water importation, what's he talking about? Water, that'll never work. It's gonna cost billions of dollars. Well. Yeah, but we have to start. We have to start, and we have to be brave.
as we continue to deal with water issues here in western Kansas and eastern Kansas, I think it's important that, you know, from a regulatory policy framework, that we stay adaptable from the company perspective. Obviously, things have changed a lot over 100 years. Making sure we maintain a good framework, a good foundation for water use, but be adaptable as things change over time. It's a challenge, I think, and an important conversation that we're going to continue to need to have and work on going forward.
If we had the policymakers sitting here and they were really interested and wanted to hear what we had to say, what I would tell them is we need to throw party lines away. We need to throw the east versus west away. We need to throw the urban versus rural away. And we need to sit down and say, what is going to be the best situation for Kansas going forward in the next decade, in the next three decades, and in the next century? Whatever comes of that discussion would be a very, very interesting solution. Because it is about Kansas. It is about America and for the future.
Heard a discouraging word, and the sky.